بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم. الحمد لله رب العالمين، رب السماوات والأرضين، والعاقبة للمتقين، والصلاة والسلام على سيدنا محمد خاتم النبيين وإمام المرسلين، وعلى آله الطيبين الطاهرين وصحابته أجمعين، وعلى كل من تبعهم بإحسان إلى يوم الدين. اللهم علمنا ما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وزدنا علما. سبحانك اللهم لا علم لنا إلا ما علمتنا إنك أنت العليم الحكيم. وبعد. Respected brothers, sisters, elders, friends, السلام عليكم ورحمة الله تعالى وبركاته. Many people are coming in inshallah slowly. Before I begin, I would like to thank the brothers at RIS and the sisters, of course, who invited me for this conference. I am honored and privileged to be here for the duration of 3 days. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala accept the efforts of all those who are involved in any way, shape or form. May Allah reward all of their efforts and their works. Ameen. The topic that I want to talk about, inshallah, I'm going to try to keep this a bit informal as well. The title is Marriage by Choice. Children versus parents, or parents versus children. It's not a boxing match, by the way. But what I want to talk about is the concept of marriage in Islam. The concept of marriage in Islam first. There's a few points that I need to cover, inshallah, in the few minutes that we have before us. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, our Lord and Creator, has given us such a beautiful religion. Such a unique religion and such a moderate religion. This religion of Islam is a moderate religion. It's considered to be the moderate religion. And Allah has made the ummah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, as Allah says in the Quran, وَكَذَلِكَ جَعَلْنَاكُمْ أُمَّةً وَسَطًا. We have made you a moderate nation. All the rules of Islam that we look at in the Quran and Sunnah, every ruling that has been prescribed by Allah or His Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, we find moderation in it. And because of this, when we look at marriage and nikah, we find that again Islam has approached this topic with moderation. Islam recognizes the human need. Islam recognizes the sexual urges of a human being. Islam realizes and recognizes that a human being has needs that need to be fulfilled. Hence, we don't have this concept of Islam that that's it. You curb your desires, your sexual needs, and that's it. No. That's one form of extremism in Islam. And at the same time, Islam has not left doors open for a person to just fulfill his needs in any way, shape, or form. Islam recognizes the natural sexual urges and needs of human beings, to the point that Allah recognizes that every human being has needs that need to be fulfilled, even the prophets of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is the reason why almost every prophet married. Allah says in the Quran, وَلَقَدْ أَرْسَلْنَا رُسُلًا مِّن قَبْلِكَ وَجَعَلْنَا لَهُمْ أَزْوَاجًا وَذُرِّيَّةً. That verily we sent prophets to you and we made wives for them. They had children, they had wives. All the prophets more or less married except for two. Even the most pious individual needs to marry. And Islam recognizes this is how a human being is created. This is a fitrah. This is the nature of the humankind. And this is why Allah allows us. Islam allows a halal, legal way for a person to fulfill his sexual needs, which is marriage, which is nikah. And at the same time, Islam forbids, totally forbids and prohibits various unlawful and haram means of marrying. Because why? Because they cause destruction in the earth. Because one of the objectives of Islam and Sharia is the preservation of lineage, حِفْظٌ nasl. And if doors were left open for a person to fulfill his needs or her needs in any way, shape or form, then fornication would be rife. Children won't know their parents. And we know today, in today's society, Over 50% of children do not know who their father is, which is not only wrong and evil, it is actually an oppression. Oppression on children, and that's why they have this rage in them, and hence the crime. It's oppression, zulm, that children do not know who their father is. They have a right. Young children have a right to know who their parents are, who their father is. So, and we know the hadith says that whenever fornication becomes prevalent in any society, prepare for the wrath of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And today we see the whole, unfortunately, the society we're living in, brothers and sisters, even Muslims have fallen prey to this. We think marriage is, you know, if you look at these, I don't know what you have in North America, in England we have all these soap programs. You have EastEnders and Emmerdale and Home and Away from Australia. I don't know where that's from. We have EastEnders, we have, I don't know, all these different soaps. Where marriages are considered to be boring, dull, excitement and fun is an illicit, unlawful relationship. A man having an affair with a woman behind somebody's back, it's all done in a secret way. There's fun, excitement. And that's the way media has portrayed everything to us. And we are conditioned and we are led to believe that marriages are boring, which is total rubbish. This is not how Islam looks at marriage. There's excitement in marriage. And therefore, I really urge young brothers and sisters, please do not watch these programs. Seriously. And even worse, you know all these Bollywood movies, the people from subcontinent watch Bollywood movies, and from, you have Hollywood, then you have Bollywood, and in Pakistan you have Lollywood. I'm sure you've heard of Lollywood. Seriously. You know the sisters watching Lollywood, watching all the films, Salman Khan and Shah Rukh Khan and this Khan and the other Khan. You know, oh yeah, when I get married, my husband, Prince Charming, will come like this and this. He'll be so romantic. That's not reality. It's just for the cameras. That's not how real life is, brothers and sisters. If you're going to think that that's how your marriage is, that doesn't happen in this world. Marriage is, there's peace, there's tranquility, there's pleasure, without a doubt. But it brings about responsibilities as well. So, you know, these programs, they corrupt our minds. We should really, really try to avoid these. So I was saying that in Islam, there is no celibacy in Islam. Islam realizes that we have needs. The hadith says, لَا صَرُورَةَ فِي الْإِسْلَامِ. There is no celibacy in Islam. In the hadith of Sahih Muslim, Sayyiduna Anas ibn Malik radiallahu anhu says that some of the companions came to ask one of the wives of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, I think it was Sayyidah Aisha radiallahu anha, wanting to know what was the practice of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam at his house. And when she informed them, they thought, yeah, look at him, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he is so close to Allah, beloved of Allah, we need to really, really practice. And so one of them said that, Wallahi la anamu, I will never sleep at night. Another one said, Wallahi la uftir, I will always keep on fasting, I will never eat. And the third one said that, La atazawwaju nisa, Wallahi la atazawwaju nisa, by Allah, I will never marry women. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he came, he was informed that these people said it. He said, Ma balu aqwamin qalu kaza wa kaza. What's wrong with such people who said this and that? That's not how you're supposed to be as Muslims. I am the Prophet of Allah. Yes. Usalli wa anamu. I perform salah at night and I go to sleep. Wa asubu wa uftir. I fast and some days I don't fast. Wa atazawwaju nisa. And I marry women. Islam is not about abstinence and abstaining from marriage. This is not what Islam teaches us. And then he said, فَمَنْ رَغِبَ عَنْ سُنَّتِي فَلَيْسَ مِنِّي. The one who turns away from my sunnah, my way, is not from me. This is the sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And there are many examples. So Islam is a religion of moderation. Teaches us. Tells us on one hand that we have needs that need to be fulfilled. At the same time, do it the right way. Halal way. Lawfully. Do not fulfill your needs in an unlawful way. And progressing from that, Islam has this concept that marriage is actually an ibadah. Seriously, brothers and sisters, a lot of times we forget. Many of us, we think marriage is just like a worldly thing. It's not a worldly thing, it's an ibadah. Worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Just like you perform salah. Just like you give zakat. You go for hajj. Seriously, there's no difference between hajj and marriage. Marriage according to Islam is considered to be a form of worship, form of ibadah, worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. It actually has two elements in it. One is the element of agreement between two, a social agreement between two individuals. So you have the man marrying the woman, it's a social agreement. And this is why one of the basic criteria of marriage, we have ijab and qabool. That one of them proposes, the other one accepts. نَكَحْتُهَا تَزَوَّجْتُهَا وَقَبِلْتُهَا. That's what a man says. So we have one element of social agreement, and we have another element in marriage, which is ibadah, worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this, you see, in business, when a man, you know, when two people, two individuals, they do a business transaction, we again have these two things, ijab and qabul, accept an offer. But when you do business, you don't have the khutbah. You know the khutbah, the sermon given before marriage? You don't, you know, the man is going to the shop, you go to somebody's shop to buy something. Alhamdulillah, ahmaduhu wa nasta'inuhu wa nastaghfiruhu, what do you want to buy, what do you want to sell? We don't do that. It's the same thing. But because marriage is actually ibadah, it has the element of a contract, but at the same time it is also a form of worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And rather, according to the madhab and the school of thought of Imam Abu Hanifa radiallahu anhu, according to Imam Abu Hanifa, the aspect of ibadah, worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, is actually more dominant. Therefore, we should have this intention in mind, that it is an ibadah, worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. One of the Hanafi scholars, Imam Al-Haskafi radiallahu anhu, he's the great jurist of the olden times, a classical scholar. He said in his book, he starts his chapter of marriage, he says, there's only two forms of worship, listen to this, there's only two forms of worship that Allah prescribed for the humankind, for human beings, since the time of Prophet Adam, peace be upon him, it exists till today and it will exist in the hereafter in Jannah as well. Only two things. And in reality there's only one. There's no salah in Jannah. If you want to, pray, by all means, pray, perform salah, no problem. There's no zakat, there's no hajj, but there's marriage in Jannah, in the akhirah, in the hereafter. One is iman, belief in Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and the other one is marriage. So it's an ibadah, it's worship of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Ultimately, we should get married. Muslims should be marrying, and seriously, we should keep this in mind. Marriage is done with the intention, it is contracted, it is performed with the intention of pleasing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Don't consider marriage to be a routine thing. It's not a routine, mundane, worldly act. And this is a problem we have today. Most of us, we have actually considered marriage to be something that's got nothing whatsoever to do with Islam, which is a totally baseless, wrong, false understanding. Marriage has everything to do with Islam. It's just like salah, it's just like zakat and hajj. It's a form of worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And I have this intention in mind, that do we think about this? When people marry, do people think about this? Very rarely. The intention, keep the intention in mind. I am marrying for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for the pleasure of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in order to please my creator, in order to look after the slave of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the intention we should have behind marrying. We never have this intention. When we get married, first thing in our head is, when we get to the hotel. That's the intention. Yes, that's it. When everything's over, and get to the hotel. Think, I am doing this for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You love your spouse for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Not even for them. It's for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Have this intention in mind. To the point that in Islam, even sexual relations between a husband and a wife, there's reward in it. It's actually considered to be charity. There's a famous hadith. Once some of the companions came to the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, peace and blessings be upon him, and they said, ذَهَبَ أَهْلُ الدُّثُورِ بِالْأُجُورِ. The people of wealth have taken away all the good rewards. Why? Because يُصَلُّونَ كَمَا نُصَلِّي. They perform salah like we do. يَصُومُونَ كَمَا نَصُومُ. They fast and we fast. But they're rich. يَتَصَدَّقُونَ بِفَضْلِ أَمْوَالِهِمْ. They have excess money that they can give in the path of Allah, charity. We don't have such money. So they have more rewards. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, wrong. أَوَلَيْسَ قَدْ جَعَلَ اللَّهُ لَكُمْ مَا تَصَدَّقُونَ بِهِ Has not Allah given you something that you can do charity with? And then he said,
إِنَّ بِكُلِّ تَسْبِيحَةٍ صَدَقَةٍ.
Every tasbih, you say, Subhanallah, act of charity, sadaqah. وَكُلُّ تَكْبِيرَةٍ صَدَقَةٍ. Every time you say, Allahu Akbar, sadaqah. وَكُلُّ تَحْمِيدَةٍ صَدَقَةٍ. Every time you say, Alhamdulillah, it's sadaqah, charity. وَكُلُّ تَهْلِيلَةٍ صَدَقَةٍ. Every time you say, La ilaha illallah, it's sadaqah. And then he said, وَأَمْرٌ لِلْمَعْرُوفِ وَنَهْيٌ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ صَدَقَةٍ. Enjoining the good and forbidding the evil. It's an actually a form of charity. And then he said, and this is the part that I want to talk to you, you know, this is the reason why I mentioned this hadith. He said, وَفِي بُضْعِ أَحَدِكُمْ صَدَقَةٍ. Subhanallah. And you know, one of you having fulfilling their sexual needs with the spouse is charity. Seriously, that's charity. Islam is a total, complete way of life. Even sexual relations. And the companions, you might be having this question in your mind. The companions also, a question came into their mind. They said, O Messenger of Allah, أَيَأْتِي أَحَدُنَا شَهْوَتَهُ وَيَكُونُ لَهُ فِيهَا أَجْرٌ. One of us, we fulfill our needs. Do we get a reward for having sex? In simple terms, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, أَرَأَيْتُمْ لَوْ وَضَعَهَا فِي حَرَامٍ أَتَانَ عَلَيْهِ وِزْرٌ. What do you think? If this individual went and fulfilled his sexual needs in a haram and lawful way, wouldn't he be committing a sin? بَلَى. The companion said, of course, Ya Rasulullah. He said, فَكَذَلِكَ. Likewise, إِذَا وَضَعَهَا لَوْ وَضَعَهَا فِي إِذَا وَضَعَهَا فِي الْحَلَالِ كَانَ لَهُ أَجْرٌ. If he fulfills his needs in a halal, lawful way, he'll be rewarded. Simple. This is a hadith in Sahih Muslim. A rigorously authenticated hadith, Sahih. So even in the sexual relationship of a man and a woman, there's reward. And therefore, I mean, there are many, many maqasid. There are many objective aims and goals of marriage, and I don't want to go into those aims and objectives of marriage. There are many such, for example, it's the first, one of the aims, one of the intentions, and seriously, before marrying, people need to keep these intentions in mind. And only then will they receive the reward for marrying. One of the intentions they should have is that it is sunnah. It's the way of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sahbihi wa sallam. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam married. Okay, وَكَفَى بِهَا a sabab. This is enough as a reason. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam married, that should be enough as a reason. But there are many, many objective aims, goals, purposes, intentions that a person may have in his mind when marrying, or in her mind when marrying. Like, for example, procreation, wanting offspring. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, تَزَوَّجُوا فَإِنِّي مُكَاثِرٌ بِكُمُ الْأُمَمِ. Marry and procreate. I will outnumber the nations by you. Also peace and tranquility and enjoying the company of one's spouse. Allah says in the Quran, وَمِنْ آيَاتِهِ خَلَقَ. And then he said, لِتَسْكُنُوا إِلَيْهَا. That you have peace and tranquility through your spouse. And there are many, many, many reasons. But having said that, as I was saying just now a few minutes ago, the most important intention a individual must have is that this is an act of ibadah. It's an act of worshipping Allah. I am marrying for the sake of Allah, in order to get close to Allah, in order to bring my spouse close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And this is why people should get married. When you look for somebody to get married to, this is the reason why the first and foremost consideration is actually what? Piety. Being close to Allah, because both spouses, the husband and wife, will be helping and assisting one another get close to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So this is the reason and this is the intention, brothers and sisters, that we should have. Okay? This is the reason, this is the intention we need to have in the mind. We are marrying for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, in order to please our Lord and Creator. And this is the reason why, you know, when you get married, when a person gets married, the brothers who've been to the masjid for the khutbah, or the sisters who've been in the marriage ceremony, the imam comes and he recites the khutbah. Have you ever reflected on the verses that are recited? You know the khutbah. The khutbah after praising Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and the praising Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There are three verses that are recited by the imam. Okay? Like the first verse in Surah An-Nisa, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala says, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ اتَّقُوا رَبَّكُمُ الَّذِي خَلَقَكُم مِّن نَّفْسٍ وَاحِدَةٍ وَخَلَقَ مِنْهَا زَوْجَهَا وَبَثَّ مِنْهُمَا رِجَالًا كَثِيرًا وَنِسَاءً وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ الَّذِي تَسَاءَلُونَ بِهِ وَالْأَرْحَامَ إِنَّ اللَّهَ كَانَ عَلَيْكُمْ رَقِيبًا. That's the first verse. What does that mean? O people, fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. your Lord who created you from one soul and then created its mate from him. And then spread through them, Adam and Hawa, peace be upon both, spread through them, رِجَالًا كَثِيرًا وَنِسَاءً, many men and women. And then he said again, وَاتَّقُوا اللَّهَ الَّذِي تَسَاءَلُونَ بِهِ وَالْأَرْحَامِ, fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, through whom you ask your mutual rights. You say, for the sake of Allah, give me my rights. That's the first verse. Remember, two times Allah mentioned taqwa, the fear of Allah. The second verse, Surah Al-Ahzab, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ وَقُولُوا قَوْلًا سَدِيدًا. Oh believers, fear Allah, say that which is correct. The third verse, يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ. By the way, nobody's getting married here. You might be saying, I'm doing khutbah, Shaykh Yastafad is already married. Two wives, by the way. Subhanallah. يَا أَيُّهَا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا اتَّقُوا اللَّهَ حَقَّ تُقَاتِهِ وَلَا تَمُوتُنَّ إِلَّا وَأَنْتُمْ مُسْلِمُونَ. Fear Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala as he is ought to be feared. And do not die except in the state of Iman. Now, one of the scholars, many scholars have said this, one of my teacher's teacher. One of my teachers, Mufti Taqi Uthmani Hafizahullah, who lives in Pakistan, Justice Taqi Uthmani's father, he used to say that if you look at his verses, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you know, this khutbah, this sermon is actually a sunnah. Okay? It's a sunnah. It's not necessary, it's a sunnah. Allah could have prescribed any other verse that deals with marriage. None of these three verses have actually even mentioned marriage. The word marriage does not even come in these verses. It's the time of marriage. Marriage is not even mentioned. Why did Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala prescribe these three verses, and why did the Messenger of Allah sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam recite these three verses from the Quran? There could be many other verses that could have been recited. Reason being, all of them have one thing in common, and what is that? Taqwa, fear of Allah, piety. Because in marriage you need piety. Before marriage, at the time of marriage, and after marriage, you need piety. You will not be able to have a prosperous marriage. You will not have blessings in your marriage unless the husband and the wife both have taqwa and the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Both are practicing, both are pious, both live their lives in guidance of the Quran and Sunnah. This is the reason why these three verses are recited at the time of nikah and marriage. So nikah is an ibadah. It's a worship. It's a form of worshiping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. A lot of emphasis has been laid on taqwa, piety, fearing Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And the famous hadith, تُنْكَحُ الْمَرْأَةُ لِأَرْبَعٍ لِمَالِهَا وَلِنَسَبِهَا وَلِجَمَالِهَا وَلِدِينِهَا فَاغْفُرْ بِذَاتِ الدِّينِ. The Messenger sallallahu ta'ala alayhi wa sallam, he says, a woman is married for four reasons, and likewise a man as well. For four reasons. Some marry because of money and wealth. It's the only sole reason some people marry, and seriously, people do. It's okay to look at wealth, but not solely at wealth. Some people just look at wealth, that's it. Seriously, overlooking everything, piety in Islam, totally overlooking good character, manners, akhlaq, wealth. When will the proposal come from such and such wealthy family? And sometimes, the man is actually looking for a wealthy woman. He's become a wife. The roles have reversed. In Islam, the man has to support the wife, not the wife supporting the man. لِمَارِهَا. Some just for family background, some just for beauty. But the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, he said, some because they marry because of deen and piety and religion. And make sure you're from those who choose a spouse based on piety and marriage, on deen and piety and the fear of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So, marriage is a form of ibadah. And like every form of ibadah, Allah has made marriage very easy and simple. Since marriage is an ibadah, a form of worshipping Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah has made nikah and marriage. And this is a very important point, brothers and sisters. In Islam, Allah has made marriage so simple, so easy, extremely simple. And the problem is today, the more marriage is simple in Islam, the more difficult we have made marriage. The more marriage is simple in Islam, We've gone the opposite. Today marrying is like, it's so difficult. Like one brother was saying to me, it's like torture trying to marry. Islam has made marriage so simple. Seriously, you know the basic requirement for a marriage. You just need, and this is cross madhab, you just need acceptance and offer and acceptance, ijab and qabool, the man and the woman. The woman says, I've given myself to your marriage. And the brother says, I've accepted you. And you just need two witnesses there. That's it. Simple, done, over and dusted with. Brother and sister, can just sit down here. Don't do that, by the way. This is not a marriage ceremony. Just two witnesses. You don't need nothing. Fixing of dowry is a condition, but not a prerequisite of marriage. Even the khutbah, the ceremony, is only a sunnah of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But today, we've made it so difficult. Parents, mothers and fathers, uncles, aunties, relatives, we've made it so difficult. We have placed restrictions and conditions upon ourselves. Dowry, subhanAllah, some cultures, extortionate amount of dowry. Sayyidina Umar ibn Khattab radiallahu anhu, once he said, أَلَا لَا تُغَالُوا صَدُقَةُ النِّسَاءِ. Beware, do not be extortionate in the amount of dowry paid to women. فَإِنَّهَا لَوْ كَانَتْ مَكْرُومَةً فِي الدُّنْيَا وَتَقْوَىً عِنْدَ اللَّهِ. Had paying extortionate amounts of money as dowry, had that been a source of honor in this world and a source of taqwa and piety by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, لَكَانَ أَوْلَاكُمْ بِهَا النَّبِيُّ صَلَى اللَّهُ عَلَيْهِ وَسَلَّمْ. Your Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam would have been the most rightful of people to pay extortionate amounts of money as dowry. But he did not. We faced so many conditions. Like once I met a brother, as a friend, when I was sitting in Syria, there was a brother I used to know from Palestine. Young brother, Palestinian. He really wants to get married. He's telling me, you know, tell you know, your friends, you know, there's some sisters studying from UK here and there. He goes, you know what? I said, your parents would have, you know, can't you get married here? He was in Damascus. He said, so difficult. Until I don't get three keys, I'm going to remain a bachelor all my life. I said, what are the three keys? Key to a car, key to a business, and key to a home. Until I don't find three keys, I'll be 50, but I won't be married. That's what he said. And today we find brothers and sisters. I come across so many brothers and sisters, seriously, and it's so troubling. There are sisters in UK and other places as well, in their 30s and 40s, unmarried, sitting at home because of all these self-imposed restrictions of their parents, of being from the same caste, from same ethnicity, same culture, same background. And I will talk about that anyway, further on, inshallah. But we've put so many restrictions. Look at the time of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. There was one companion, Abdul Rahman ibn Awf, radiallahu anhu. Once he's a Sahabi, a Muhajir, one of the companions who actually accepted Islam, one of the early companions accepted Islam. In Medina al-Munawwara, once he came to the masjid of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, the Prophet's mosque, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam looked at him and he saw some kind of yellow mark stain on him. He said, Abdul Rahman, what's this yellow mark? He said, oh, yeah, I got married. And, you know, I had applied some perfume and this mark is from the perfume that I had applied. I married the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Now, look at this incident. You've got the Messenger of Allah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, but you're not even informing him. Got married, simple, it's done, you know, you were busy. Today, until my great-granddad and great-grandma and this auntie and that uncle and this one from Pakistan and this one from India, this one from Iraq and this one from Saudi Arabia doesn't come, marriage is not done. Seriously, it's a problem. I'm not saying that don't call people. A'udhu Billah. I'm not saying that. Oh, Sayyidina Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam invited Abu Bakr and Umar when he married his daughter Fatima radiallahu anha. But going out of your means and delaying marriages for brothers and sisters, that is totally against the teachings of Islam. He got married Abdul Rahman ibn Awf, the Messenger, and what did the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam say to him? If it was somebody like me or another imam somewhere, subhanAllah, a'udhu billah, astaghfirullah, don't talk to me anymore. You didn't tell me? You got married, you didn't even invite me? The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, no complaint whatsoever. He just said to him, Barakallahu lak wa baraka alik. Allah give you barakah. Allah bless you in your marriage. Awlim walau bishatin. And then he said, just make sure you do a walima feast, even if it's by sacrificing or slaughtering a goat. That's what he just said. Likewise, there's another companion, Jabir, radiallahu anhu, with him as well. He was actually, they went, he in Medina, and they were returning from a battle, and the Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, was very close to him. He was talking to him, and then he said to him, when they were talking, Jabir, radiallahu anhu, he said to the Messenger, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, that when we were returning, he said, Ya Rasulullah, inni hadithu ahdin bi'urf. I just recently married a Messenger of Allah. He said, Tazawajta? Did you get married in Medina? He said, yes, I was married. And then he asked him, Abikran am Tayyiban, was it a virgin or a non-virgin? And the hadith goes on. But again here, he did not even inform the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, and the same thing, he gave him dua. Barakallahu lak, wa baraka alayk, wa jama'a baynakuma fi khayr. Allah bless both of you. Allah unites you with khayr, with good. We have this problem of, and you know what, the result of this, brothers and sisters, when we close the doors of halal, then the net results, the consequence is that the doors of haram will open up. And this is why today we see fornication is rife. We see unlawful activity taking place. Because we have made it so difficult. And especially parents, and I'm addressing the parents and the elders here more. We have made it difficult for our young people to get married today. The society out there, it's written out there. It's difficult for people to live out there today, seriously. It's difficult for married people out there, let alone people who are not married. It's so difficult. The times we're living in, and especially in the place we're living in. And yet, parents are not budging, because just based on pride and vainglory and boasting of their ancestors. Seriously, it's a problem. And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam says, إِنَّ اللَّهَ قَدْ أَذْهَبَ عَنْكُمْ عُبِّيَّةَ الْجَاهِلِيَّةِ Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has removed this ubiyya, this stupidity of jahiliyyah and your vainglory and your pride and boasting of your ancestors. It's got nothing whatsoever to do with Islam. And when we close the doors of halal for people to make it easy for people to marry, we were supposed to keep marriages easy and let our young people marry in an easy way. When we make it difficult for them, then the doors of haram open. And then that's when fornication becomes rife. And that's when all sorts of unlawful activities take place. And the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa alihi wa sallam, he himself actually said this. In a hadith in Sunan al-Tirmidhi, he said, إِذَا خَطَبَ إِلَيْكُمْ He was addressing the parents and the guardians. He said, إِذَا خَطَبَ إِلَيْكُمْ مَنْ تَرْضَوْنَ دِينَهُ وَخُلُقَهُ فَزَوِّجُوهُ O father, O guardian, O parents, when you have received a proposal from somebody whose manners and whose deen you are happy with, then marry your daughters off with them. إِلَّا تَفْعَلُوا تَكُنْ فِتْنَةٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ وَفَسَادٌ عَرِيدٌ If you don't do that, there'll be tribulation in the land. If you don't do that, there'll be widespread destruction. Get them married off. And one of the things he said, ثَلَاثَةٌ لَا تُؤَخِرَهَا He was addressing Sayyidina Ali رضي الله عنه. He said, وَالْأَيِّمُ إِذَا وَجَدْتَ لَهَا كُفْوًا A non-married woman, when you find a suitable spouse, do not delay this marriage. Marry them off as quickly as possible. We have so many cultural practices. This is responsibility. Parents have great responsibility. Some parents just don't care. You know, some parents, they just like, get it. You know, they marry whoever they want. That's also another extreme approach. You see, there's a difference in Islam. Sometimes there's misconception, arranged marriages, forced marriages. I want to make it clear to you, there's a big difference between arranged marriages and forced marriages. Arranging is to arrange. Basically, it just means to arrange. You have to arrange everything before you do anything in this world. You're not just going to have two brother and sister come down here and sit down and get married. If you find somebody go in the corridor, oh, sister, come here, all right, let's sit down, marry. It's not going to happen like that. You have to arrange. That's what arranged marriage is. That's what arranging means. Parents help. Parents assist. It's an effective means, a good means of what? Helping your children and your, relatives get married. So some parents just don't care. And they should realize that they have responsibility. Imam al-Bayhaqi mentions a hadith in his book, Shu'ab al-Iman. Ibn Abbas radiallahu anhu narrates, Man wulida lahu waladun. The one who has a child, a man or a woman who has a child,
فليحسن اسمه. Then he should give a good name to that child when a child is born. وأدبه, teach him good manners. فإذا بلغ, when the child matures, فليزوجه, he should marry that child off. فإن بلغ, when the child matures and age and becomes and reaches an age of marriage, and the father fails to marry the child off, فأصاب إثما, and the child commits a sin, the Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم says, فإن إثمه على أبيه, the sin is on the father. You know, when I mentioned this once in a talk recently, a brother came to me, he goes to me, I'm chilling. I don't know if you use that phrase here. I go, why are you chilling for? He said, you know what? I say I can do whatever I want. My dad's going to get all the sin. Okay? I said, no, it doesn't mean like that. Of course, you have to avoid sins. Your father gets the sin as well as you. It doesn't mean that the responsibilities are lifted from you. So, parents have responsibilities. But forced marriage and forced marriages are totally, completely, categorically forbidden, haram in Islam. I could not condemn it enough. Every hadith book you pick up, every book of fiqh, whether the Shafi'i madhab, the Hanafi school of thought, the Maliki, the Hanbali, you find a word, ijbar, wala ijbara. In the Hanafi madhab, there's a book, basic text that is taught in the second or the first year when students study. Imam al-Quduri says in his Mukhtasar, he says, وَلَا يَجُوزُ لِلْوَلِيِّ إِجْبَارُ الْبِكْرِ الْبَالِغَةِ وَإِنْ أَبَتْ فَلَا جَوَازَ عَلَيْهَا. It is not permissible whatsoever for a guardian to force marriage on his young daughter or son. And if she refuses, then there is no way over her. You can't force her. And this is taken from the hadith. The Messenger صلى الله عليه وسلم says in the hadith, Bukhari and Muslim, متفقٌ عليه, الْبِكْرُ تُسْتَأْمَرُ فِي نَفْسِهَا. A virgin woman should be asked, explicit permission must be taken. In abad fala jawaza alayha, la tunkahu al-ayyim hatta tusta'mar wa la tunkahu al-bikr hatta tusta'zan. A non-virgin woman, you can't marry her off unless you take explicit permission. You can't marry a virgin woman as well until you seek her permission. Clear hadith of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wasallam. But today we have a big problem. I've come across so many cases. There's one sister recently who contacted me. She wants to marry only for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. She wants to marry for Islamic reasons. She wants a husband who is pious, practicing. Parents are having none of it. They want somebody else who's my brother's daughter, my sister's son. That's it. They're not refusing to budge or move. This whole caste system is totally in contradiction with the teachings of the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, when he wanted to marry his daughter Fatima radiallahu anha off, he asked her, he came to her and said, "Inna ya Fatima, O Fatima, inna Aliyan yazkuruka." Ali radiallahu ta'ala anhu is proposing to you. And then she consented, and only then he married her off. There's a hadith in Surah Nasa'i, a woman came to Sayyida Aisha radiallahu anha and said, "Inna abi zawajani ibn akhi لِيَرْفَعَ مِنْ خَسِيسَتِهِ." My father married me off to my cousin brother so that, you know, my cousin brother's status is elevated. That's the only reason. Sometimes parents do ridiculous things. I'm not saying all parents are like that, subhanAllah. No, some parents, and that's how I tell a lot of the young people, that think, listen to them, consider the proposal they are bringing for you. They may be khair and good in what they're saying. Do istikhara, do istishara, seek counseling. Think about it, consider, but then, if you're not happy, the final, ultimate choice is yours. And especially if the potential spouse or somebody who they are proposing is somebody not practicing, then you have complete right to refuse. Children are not sinful whatsoever in refusing as long as they do it with adab, with respect, without arguing. There's no argumentation, not being confrontational. This is what Islam teaches. So this hadith, this woman said, my father married me off to my cousin brother just because to elevate his status. وَإِنِّي كَرِهْتُ ذَلِكَ. I dislike this fact. The Messenger, so she said this to Sayyidah Aisha radiallahu anha. After a while, the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam entered the house and she mentioned that to him. He said, call your father. And he said to the father, what have you done? وَجَعَلَ الْأَمْرَ إِلَيْهَا. And then made the father, made him agree that now she has the full choice. They annulled the marriage and she's got the choice. And I'm coming to an end, inshallah. Got two messages. I'm really finishing soon. وَجَعَلَ الْأَمْرَ إِلَيْهَا.
Okay, gave, and then the Messenger sallallahu alayhi wa sallam said, okay, it's your right. Okay, you want to stay in the marriage, you stay in the marriage. You want to go out of the marriage, you go out of the marriage. You know what she said after that? She said, إِنِّي قَدْ أَجَزْتُ مَا فَنَعَ أَبِي. It's okay, I'm happy with what my father did. I'll marry him off. I'll marry this cousin brother of mine. No problem. And then she said, إِنَّمَا أَرَدْتُ. The only reason why I did this was أَنْ أَعْلَمْ هَلْ لِلنِّسَاءِ مِنَ الْأَمْرِ شَيْءٌ أَمْ لَا. Whether I just did this to know whether women have rights in Islam or not. SubhanAllah. This is a hadith in Sunan Nasa'i. Allah says in the Quran, يَا أَيُّهَا النَّاسُ إِنَّا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ مِنْ ذَكَرٍ وَأُنْثَى وَجَعَلْنَاكُمْ شُعُوبًا وَقَبَائِلَ لِتَعَارَفُوا. He created you from one man, one woman. The only reason we have different tribal groups and different ethnicities and different backgrounds is only لِتَعَارَفُوا, so that you recognize one another. Not for arguments and boasting and pride. So therefore, my appeal is, and I'm going to conclude with this appeal to my beloved fathers and mothers and uncles and aunties and brothers and sisters, for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, I am pleading you and begging you, for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, make it easy for your children out there. Make marriages easy and simple as Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has kept it simple. Do not make it difficult for people, because it is very difficult out there. And with this, inshallah, أقول قولي هذا وأستغفر الله وصلى الله وسلم على سيدنا محمد وعلى آله وصحبه وسلم والحمد لله رب العالمين.